Good morning, everyone. This is the day that the Lord has made, and we shall rejoice and be glad in it. Welcome to each and every one of you this morning, and welcome in Jesus' name. Anyone is a visitor, we ask you to sign the guest register in the narthex. I say welcome, and I'm not always myself aware of who are the visitors and who are regular. I'm still getting to know you. And you're very patient that you're putting up with us here in this process. It's a good thing. We thank you for that. This is a day that we can really worship the Lord. Isn't that good? He has blessed us with rain. Oh my. But we need to pray for those down in Texas that have really been hit. It's very, very sad. People have lost their lives. So we certainly want to have that on our prayer list for this time and into the future. Our announcements are before us, and I'm not going to take a lot of time and insult you with you not being able to, because you are able to read. But just to mention that Thursday is the Ascension World Day of Prayer service here in the evening at 7 p.m. So we will combine the two celebrations this year. Then also mention there that to see this on, that is the National Day of Prayer, will be broadcast live. So you have the information to direct you to that. We saw Viola this week, and she told me she was 90 years old. And then we paused and she said, oh no, she says, I'm 91. So be sure to send cards to her and just encourage her. She's such a blessing and such a fun person to visit, and we appreciate that. Call committee meets on Monday at 7:30. Also moving into the week, that this evening will be the meeting of the FLY and the last fellowship project until September. Call committee will, as I mentioned, meet at 7:30. That on Tuesday, the men's Bible study, but the council does not meet Tuesday night. It meets Wednesday at 7 o'clock. So council members, please note that. The other announcements, looking forward, Prairie View Lutheran Home, that's on May 11th at 2 p.m. is the basket auction. And then the note here regarding health kits that they're beginning to put that together. And then the golf tournament on June 12th, sign up sheets for that. I believe those are the announcements. If I am correct. Those being the announcements then. Let us turn to the Lord for a word of prayer.
O Lord, our Maker, Redeemer, and Comforter, we're this morning again gathered together in your presence, and our purpose is to worship you, our living Lord, to hear your holy word. We pray that you would, through the preaching of your word, through the hymns that are sung, through the scriptures that are read,
I invite you to stand if you're able and to sing together the opening hymn, Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee. Let us bow before the Lord and together confess our sins. Almighty God, our Maker and Redeemer, we poor sinners confess to you that we are by nature sinful and unclean, and that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. Therefore, we flee for refuge to your infinite mercy and ask you for Christ's sake, grant us forgiveness of all our sins, and by your Holy Spirit, increase in us true knowledge of you and of your will, and true obedience to your word, to the end that by your grace we may come to eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Father has had mercy upon us and has given his Son to die for us. The promise of Scripture is that whoever confesses his sins to the Lord will receive forgiveness through the faithfulness and the righteousness of Christ. God grant this, that this may be the experience of us all. Amen. You may be seated.
The Old Testament lesson today is out of Jeremiah 29, verses 11 through 14. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future. Then you will call on me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you. And you will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. I will be found by you, declares the Lord, and will bring you back from captivity. I will gather you from all the nations and places where I have banished you, declares the Lord, and will bring you back to the place from which I carried you into exile. The epistle lesson is from James, first chapter, verses 22 through 27. Do not merely listen to the Lord and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says. Anyone who listens to the word but does not do what it says is like someone who looks at his face in the mirror and after looking at himself goes away and immediately forgets what he looks like. But whoever looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues in it, not forgetting what they have heard but doing it, they will be blessed in what they do. Those who consider themselves religious and yet do not keep a tight rein on their tongues can deceive themselves, and their religion is worthless. Religion that God our Father accepts as pure and faultless in this, to look after orphans and widows in their distress and to keep oneself from being polluted by the world. Here ends the reading.
Confess together our holy Christian faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth,
and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven and is seated on the right hand of God the Father Almighty, from where he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Morning by turning to hymn number 525, I Know Whom I Have Believed. Thank you.
had I not known, I am believed and am persuaded that He is able to keep me out of the gospel lesson for the day is found in the gospel according to St. John, chapter 16, and I'll be reading verses 23 through 28. We do that in Jesus' name. And in that day, you will ask me no question. Truly I say to you, truly, truly, I say to you, you shall ask the Father for anything, He will give it to you in my name. Until now you have asked for nothing in my name. Ask and you will receive, that your joy may be full. These things I have spoken to you in figurative language. An hour is coming. An hour is coming. I will speak no more to you in figurative language, but will tell you plainly of the Father. In that day you will ask in my name, and I will do. And I do not say to you that I will request the Father on your behalf. For the Father himself loves you, because you have loved me and have believed that I came forth from the Father. I came forth from the Father and have come into the world. I am leaving the world again and going to the Father. Now, Father, these are thy words. This is the truth. And I pray that you would just lead us into the truth that you desire to have spoken here this morning. May I be your faithful servant to speak your word. Amen. You may be seated. Today's May Day. Now, some of you are maybe of my genre, you're old like me, and I don't know if you did this in this area, but up in my little hometown, up in Minnesota, we used to make May baskets. Sound familiar to anybody? And then you'd fill them up with goodies, and then you'd go over to the neighbor or whoever it is that you wanted to do it, and you'd put that on, very quietly put it on the door, and then rap on the door, and then run for it. Go beat it out of there. And it was fun, you know, to see the people come out, open up the door, and look around and see who did it. Try to catch who it was that did it. It was a fun thing. to just live this little gift, this little piece of kindness, and to do it in a fun way. Now, I don't know where the idea came from, where the tradition came from. That would be interesting. I didn't look it up either. Didn't take the time to do that. But I'm sure that we could use more of the May basket spirit in our society today, don't you believe? I think we could have a bit more kindness in our society, and edifying one another and building up one another. Well, that's what we have in our text here this morning. That Jesus, as he prepares his people to get ready to for him to go, be separated from them and go into heaven on Ascension Day, as we will be celebrating that this week. He gave them many gifts along the way to prepare them for that. And he does that for us today. The gift of the promise, the gift of prophecy, the gift of prayer. All of these are just God-sourced, God-given gifts that he wants to give to help and encourage his people along the way. He doesn't want us seen stumbling and missing the mark on things. His desire is to be with us and to help us. And the more we depend on him, and the more we see him in our lives and doing his will, it blesses him and it encourages him. And he in turn, what does he do? He encourages and it blesses us. So first thing I want to point out this morning are the prayer promises given in these verses. On Thursday of the coming week, we'll have the National Day of Prayer. At least one day a week in the United States, we pause for prayer. I sure hope it's more than that, don't you? And I know that you do that here. And I want to encourage you to that end. Prayer is a wonderful gift that God has given to us, in which we can express ourselves to God. But you know, what Jesus is doing here in our verses is taking them through a transition time. And sometimes we just don't understand that there was this, that things were different prior to Jesus, as far as prayer is concerned. You see, prior to Jesus, they didn't pray in Jesus' name, did they? Have you ever thought about that before? But you know, did you hear, and I would say open up your bulletin, open up your Bibles to Jeremiah 29:11. Isn't that a wonderful, wonderful portion of scripture that Craig read here this morning? 29:11. For I know the plans that I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans for what? For welfare, and not for calamity. But listen here, to give you what? A future and a hope. A future and a hope. I know the plans I have you, he says. And then what's it? You will call upon me and come and pray to me. And there's the second promise he gives us. And I'm going to listen. I'm going to listen. I'm going to listen. I want to hear from you. It's my heart to want to hear from you. And I'm not hearing enough from you. I'm just talking about myself. How about you? And then he goes on, you will seek me and find me when you search me for me with all your heart. You will find me. You ever play hide and seek when you're a kid? 1, 2, 3 on whoever, you run back to goal. One of the fun times for us in Bolivia, we would all be in different places, but we'd come for our annual conference on Coaba, and Claire and I had the privilege of serving there on Coaba at the Bible school, and it was just fun seeing the missionaries come once a year. We could see them way up in the, they came out of the, over the pass and down into the valley, and And we'd wait for them, and our kids would be so excited, and when the vehicle would pull up, they'd run out, and they'd see each other, and then off they'd go, you know, and we just had great times. But then some would stay after, and I particularly remember Bob and Joyce Andrews, and their kids were about the same age as our kids. And I don't know, maybe you know, you've heard of Pastor Christian Andrews. Well, he was one of our kids. He's a pastor in the FLC. And we would then in the evening, at night, when it got dark, then we would play Captain May I or Kick the Can or one of those sort of games. And I remember Nathan Andrews seeing me, and they all the Andrews kids said, "Oh, Dick Gunderson looks just like what was his name, Uncle something or another. I can't remember his name now." But when he saw me, he ran for goal, and he said, 1, 2, 3, Uncle Nathan or whatever, Uncle. And we all went, "Who?" It all broke up. It's one thing to seek, but you got to find the wrong person. And there's a lot of people going to the wrong place today. They're looking for peace in the wrong places. And there is only one place that we can come to, isn't it? And where is that? In Jesus. Yeah, you got it right, Matthew. Jesus, that's right. And then he goes on to say, "And I will be found by you, declares the Lord, and I will restore your fortunes and will gather you from afar." Well, what's so significant about that? Well, these were this was the nation Israel carried off into bondage. They're a long ways from home. "I have driven you where I've driven you. The Lord, I will bring you back to the place where I sent you into exile. I will bring you to myself." And that's what Jesus is doing here in these verses. "I am going ahead of you, and I'm going to take you to myself." Jesus is the waymaker. He has opened the door into heaven itself. Prayer in the Old Testament was in the name of the patriarchs, Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, and God our Father, remember us, God our Father. But when Jesus came into the world, he didn't take away the Father's authority, the Father's fatherliness and the Father's love, but he enhanced it. He opened it even greater to us. Now Jesus specifically says to the disciples, offering a new dimension to prayer, "Why don't you just pray in my name?" In Luke 11, the disciples observing prayer asked, "Lord, teach us to pray." So what did Jesus do? "Our Father who art in heaven," to pray like this. So Jesus even teaches about prayer. I just had the joy of going into one of the children's Sunday school rooms this morning, and it just blessed my heart to hear the immediate response to the questions about the commandments and the meaning of the commandments, and also how the not only the commandments have meaning, but they're known and held. Well, God also is teaching us. He is teaching us to pray and to pray in his name. Now Jesus broadens the promise of prayer by asking, by telling us to ask the Father in his name, and Jesus will give it to us. As Longhi rightly says in his commentary, and I like this statement, "The name of Jesus, therefore, is not merely the motive, but the medium." But he doesn't take away the motive. But it is the medium by which we can go to the Father. Jesus told them that until then, to pray in his name, asking, and it would be given to them. So that's the second thing I want to mention here this morning. First, that there is a prayer promise. And secondly, the gift of answered prayer is God loving you and me. History tells us that too many people pray to satisfy an angry God, which was especially true among the people of Old Testament times and is especially true of those who do not know the Jehovah God or Jesus Christ. They are seeking to appease an angry God. Too many pray to get something. Too many are ready to pray when they're in need, but they forget about it the rest of the time. Ever fall into that trap? What do we call that? At least from the Second World War, that saying developed, foxhole Christianity. All the promises that are made in foxholes. But I believe it's a great tragedy that far too many people do not even pray at all. Oh, folks, think of what God's provided for us. That we can come to Him, pray in Jesus' name, and He wants to hear us. That prayer is not something where you end up with a busy line or a bad connection, but that the way is open. He has done that for us because it is His desire to hear us. What spoke to me this week, it has to do with that. Yeah, I spent time in these verses, and when I was finally caught with the great truth here that God loves us so much and is more than ready to answer prayer because of His great love for us. That's his attitude. One of the keys to me was based on a question I had when the Greek word phileo is used there instead of the Greek word agapao. Now the difference between phileo and agapao is that phileo really is a kind of love. And by the way, there are three or four different words in Greek for the word love, word love in English. But the agapao is a God divine love. You can't do it. I can't do it. Because it's a God-sourced love. Now we can receive it and share it. Don't hold on to it. Don't keep that precious thing to yourself when you realize God loves you. But the phileo is the one where we get Philadelphia from, brotherly love. And I wondered then, why in the world did Jesus use phileo love here? Why didn't He talk about agapao love? Here's what really came through to me. You see, He's talking about the Father's love, fatherly love. Fatherly love is really, really critical. We need a Father's love. You know, I had a good father. I didn't realize it at the time. He had his problems. He was Norwegian. Not much he could do about that. He was bald, and I got it from him. He was tough. I guess I didn't get that from him. But you know, I'll never forget coming home from playing outside, crawling up in his lap, him letting me do that. And I think I can even still smell my father. I tell you, it helps me understand my Heavenly Father. I lament. If there's any one of you who had a bad father, that gets in the way. I admonish you fathers, be good fathers. I see a really good father over here with his son. I just love that. I just love that. And a good mom as well. Bless you. I want to encourage you, to all of you as fathers, thanks for being good fathers, because it helps your children understand our Father God. Because what Jesus is saying here is that you don't even have to ask things in my name, because the Father wants to give you these things out of love. My goodness, John 3:16, isn't that it? Isn't it there? For God? Hey, you're doing better, guys. Thank you. You're with me. God so loved the world, everyone, that he gave. Amen. And he's still doing that. It's his desire to do that. And if I don't make this point clear, I have failed today. For you need to understand, I need to understand that God has done everything possible to make it for us to open the doors. And you know, we're going to be in a little bit here, receiving here at the Lord's table, another expression of this gift of love, of what he's done for us. But before we do, I just want to close with the last point, that of Jesus' testimony and promise to us. We know that Jesus was given by the Father, like I just shared. Hendrickson, in his commentary, writes, and this is really good, I really appreciate this, to save his people not only from a task laid upon him, it was just as emphatically the result of his own free choice. Jesus, of his own free choice, came into the world and laid down his life for you and me. Hence, I came out, I am come, I am leaving, I am going. It is as if Jesus said, I myself do all this. The Father does not compel me to do it. Satan and the world cannot prevent me from doing it. I have done it. I am doing it. There are three interesting tenses of the verbs here. The first is the aorist in the Greek, and it says, I came, punctiliar. It happened. It's a done deal. And then he goes on to say, I have come. I have come into the world. That's a perfect, in the perfect tense. It's completed in the past, and it comes right along up to today. You get that? I came, I have come. And then he says in the third time, I am, present tense. In other words, it's now and ongoing. I am leaving the world, present with an prophetic implication. And then the fourth time he says, I am going. Isn't I gone? I'm going with the present action carrying into the future, and it is prophetic. And you know what? His prophecy was true, because that's exactly what he did. And that's our hope. He's the first one to do it, to die and to be resurrected, to ascend into heaven, to prepare a place for us. He is still actively preparing a place. The promise to us this morning is that Jesus is present. He is here. As we partake of his body and his blood, let's do it in thanks for such a great gift. Let's participate as he is in, with, and under the bread and the wine. We believe that. Come, Lord Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Father, we thank you. We thank you that we can get our eyes upon you this morning, what you've said and what you've done. And then also, thank you for helping us to see the Father. Oh, we need to see you, Father, the great love, the desire of your heart, that we be with you. And now, O Lord, as we continue our service and enter into the communion service this morning, thank you for that great gift of the Lord's Supper and for the great gift of your being here, present with us. Amen. Continue this morning by singing the Nearer My God to the number 602. 602. We will continue our worship service this morning by, at this time, receiving our tithes and our offerings. You may be seated. I just was given an announcement here, and I guess this is a good thing, isn't it, to have an announcement in the middle of the service? When you can announce that we have new grandparents here, Wayne and Kathy Lehman, that they had a little one, Elise Lucille, born on the 25th of April. Congratulations to you folks. Lord, blessing on you. Being parents, that fit in for the day, didn't it? We'll continue with our communion service this morning. Dear friends in Christ, in order that you may receive this holy sacrament in a worthy manner, you should carefully consider what you must now believe and do. From the words of Christ, this is my body which is given for you. This is my blood which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. You should believe that Jesus Christ is present with his body and blood as the words declare. From Christ's words, for the forgiveness of sins, you should also believe that Jesus gives you his body and blood to strengthen your assurance that your sins are forgiven. And finally, you should do as Christ commands you when he says, take, eat, drink of it, all of you. This do in remembrance of me. Now, if you believe these words of Christ and do as he has commanded, then you have properly examined yourselves and may eat Christ's body, drink his blood in a worthy manner. You should also unite in giving thanks to Almighty God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, for so great a gift, and should love one another with a pure heart, and thus with the whole Christian church have comfort and joy in Christ our Lord. To this end, may God the Father give you his grace and through our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. We're going to have just a short pause for a personal prayer here now, and then we will continue by praying together the prayer that our Lord has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Our Lord Jesus Christ, in the night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. After the same manner also he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he drank from it, and he said to them, this is the cup of the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often you drink it in remembrance of me. The ushers will now wait upon you at this time. Paul writes to Peter, or Peter in his letter actually writes, that you may obey Jesus Christ and be sprinkled with his blood. May grace and peace be in fullest measure. Our crucified and risen Lord Jesus Christ, who has now bestowed upon you his holy body and blood, by which he has made full satisfaction for all your sins, strengthen and preserve you in the one true faith, unto everlasting life. Amen. Depart then in that peace. Let us bow before the Lord and give thanks in prayer. Now, Father, as we come to the end of this communion service and this worship service this morning, we want to thank you, Almighty and Everlasting God, for you have been here to refresh us with your word, with these gracious gifts. And we ask that your infinite mercy to strengthen us. Strengthen us, Father, to walk rightly before you, that you'd support us in our trials. And then you would make us fervent in our love for you and for our fellow men. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Bow your hearts to the Lord and receive his benediction. And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be and abide with you all. Amen. We'll turn to hymn number 284 in closing. Sent forth by God's blessing. Shall we stand? Go in peace. Serve the Lord.